didn't know. But they had to wire to a non.
Today, I am so happy to see everybody here. Obviously, we have soup after church, so please come on down. We're going to ask whoever can help serve to serve, and we're going to ask everybody to help clean up as well, because there's a lot that needs to be done after Soup Sunday. We have to put all that soup into the courts and stuff so that it's available. So anybody that can help with the serving or the cleanup afterwards, it would be greatly appreciated, and we hope everybody enjoys. We have 13 different types of soup down there, so everyone will find something they like, I'm sure.
Game night, right? Joanne, tell us about game night.
No, Saturday.
December 21st, 2003. Come out and enjoy a night of fellowship and pancakes. Who's doing the cooking? Cindy has the team. So if y'all are a part of that team, raise your hand so we can show you some love. There's only one person on the team, two people.
That's the shepherds right here.
Shepherds, come on, bro.
Come on here, little shepherd back there.
All right, hey, little shepherd back there. Hey, all right. All right, so let's give a round of applause for our little shepherds. Awesome. Did I miss anybody? Any other announcements?
We're good.
Awesome. Please rise for the call to worship. Make a joyful noise to the Lord and all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture.
Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise.
Thank you. full of comfort and overwhelming awe. May we take time to be attentive to your presence and to your call to love others as we are loved by you. Give us the eyes to see your grace in our encounters, the ears to hear of your good news among us, and the voice to speak your truth, and the hands to serve you. Amen.
Please turn in the red panel to number 641, and we will sing, Fill My Cup, Lord.
Thank you.
Don't be afraid to step out on faith, babe. You'll never know what comes when you step out on faith. It's truly a blessing. It's hard, but sometimes we need that money. Life feels more expensive now. You know, it's real out here. But when you lean in Jesus' arms, it's something special when he leans right back. So, if you are willing to give, our ushers will be coming forward, and you can place your tithes and offerings in the...
Oh, my God, what is that called?
The plate.
Oh, my God, why can I ever remember that?
If you are online, you can give online. You can mail your tithes and offerings to the church, or you can drop it off in the mail slot here at the building. As the ushers come forward, we will be singing hymn 629 in the United Methodist Hymnal, You Satisfy the Hungry Heart, verse 1. For the kingdom of God. So we thank you for being here. and sisters, if you could point your hands out to the minister of God, just like this. Nope, it's not good. Go ahead, dude. You're good. Yes, we're going to pray for him and his wife. Lord God, we thank you for him. We thank you for the messenger of God this day. We thank you for blessing him and sending him our way to 36 East Broad Street here in Burlington. We ask you, God, to bless him, teach him, show him how you want your word delivered to your people in a way that our hearts will be filled and we run out of here like our pants are on fire, Lord, for you. We thank you, God, for all that you're going to do, that you are doing in his life and you will continue to do in his life and the life of his family and his lovely wife, Stephanie. We thank you, God, for this love offering that he is going to give us today and in the wake of his sermon. Now, Lord God, we thank you for just showing up and showing out in him and in us. We ask these things in the name of your son, Jesus. Amen. We will now hear from our sanctuary choir the anthem, Table of Desire.
Let us join our voices together as we ask God to speak a relevant word to us today from the scripture and the sermon. Let us pray. God of mercy, you promised never to break your covenant with us. Amid all the changing words of our generation, speak your eternal word that does not change. Then may we respond to your gracious promises with faithful and obedient lives through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. In this lesson today, we find the prophet Elijah in deep depression and despair. God speaks to him and gives him another great assignment. Let us listen for the word of the Lord as it comes to us from the book of 1 Kings. Ahab told Jezebel that Elijah had done all that Elijah had done. How he had killed all Baal's prophets with the sword. Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah with this message. May the gods do whatever they want to me if this time tomorrow I haven't made your life like the life of one of them. Elijah was terrified. He got up and ran for his life. He arrived at Beersheba in Judah and left his assistant there. He himself went further on into the desert, a day's journey. He finally sat down under a solitary broom bush. He longed for his own death. It's more than enough, Lord. Take my life, because I am no better than my ancestors. He lay down and slept under the solitary broom bush. Then suddenly, a messenger tapped him and said, "Get up! Eat something!" Elijah opened his eyes and saw flatbread baked on glowing coals and a jar of water right by his head. He ate, drank, and then went back to sleep. The Lord's messenger returned a second time and tapped him. "Get up," the messenger said. "Eat something, because you have a difficult road ahead of you." Elijah got up, ate, drank, and went refreshed by that food for 40 days and nights until he arrived at Horeb, God's mountain. There he went into a cave and spent the night. The Lord's word came to him and said, "Why are you here, Elijah?" Elijah replied, "I've been very passionate for the Lord God of heavenly forces because the Israelites have abandoned your covenant. They have torn down your altars, and they have murdered your prophets with the sword. I'm the only one left, and now they want to take my life too." The Lord said, "Go out and stand at the mountain before the Lord. The Lord is passing by." A very strong wind tore through the mountains and broke apart the stones before the Lord. But the Lord wasn't in the wind. After the wind, there was an earthquake, but the Lord wasn't in the earthquake. After the earthquake, there was a fire, but the Lord wasn't in the fire. After the fire, there was a sound, thin, quiet. When Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his coat. He went out and stood at the cave's entrance. A voice came to him and said, "Why are you here, Elijah?" He said, "I've been very passionate for the Lord God of heavenly forces because the Israelites have abandoned your covenant. They have torn down your altars and they have murdered your prophets with the sword. I'm the only one left. And now they want to take my life too. I said that before. The Lord said to him, go back to the desert and to Damascus and anoint Hazael as king of Aram. Also anoint Jehu, Nimshi's son, as king of Israel, and anoint Elijah from Abel Meholah, Shaphat's son, to succeed you as prophet. Whoever escapes from the sword of Hazael, Jehu will kill. Whoever escapes from the sword of Jehu, Elijah will kill. But I have preserved those who remain in Israel, totaling 7,000. All those whose knees haven't bowed down to Baal, whose mouths haven't kissed him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Pastor Kim will bring the message today called
from Taiwan, one of the members of my church who we serve there, wrote me on the Facebook Messenger. She said, will you kindly pray for my depression? I am suffering. And then a little bit later, she wrote again. She said, it's hard to live with bipolar disorder type 2. I pray for the Lord's mercy and grace. Medicine did not help much. Most of the time, I am depressed. My brother suffered from bipolar disorder too. Have you ever been depressed? Yeah. Well, there is, you know, a clinical kind of depression, and sometimes you need therapy for that and more help than what I'm talking about in my sermon today. But if you've ever been depressed, even for a little while, you know what it feels like. Jimmy Buffett, Stephanie and I are fans of Jimmy Buffett. We're not exactly parrotheads, but he came to Virginia Beach not long ago, and Stephanie got to go hear him and his band. It was really a great time for them, but he captured the listlessness and the feeling of futility when slumped in depression with those words that thank you for playing that. Wasted away in Margaritaville, searching for that lost shaker of salt. Some people claim there's a woman to blame, but I know it's my own fault. I didn't say the offending word either, so. Who would have guessed that Elijah could have sung that song? We find him depressed and despondent, lying under a small broom tree, wishing that his life would end. Because he felt defeated. He felt abandoned. He felt unloved. He believed his mission and his purpose in life had completely failed. He believed that he was a failure. And who would have guessed such a thing? Because just a few days before, he was such a tower of strength. He had been on a roll. He had accurately predicted a 3-year drought it had come to pass. And then God had sustained him along with the help of some ravens who brought bread and meat as he was hiding out by the brook Cherith. And then he went in and resided with a widow for some time who gave him quarters, and God fed them miraculously by multiplying the flour and the oil, making little cakes. And he even was able to raise the widow's son from the dead in the story. He single-handedly took on 450 prophets of Baal, not to mention the 400 prophets of Asherah on Mount Carmel, and God answered the sacrifice by fire. Who would have guessed that had just happened? But now he is depressed, terrified, wanting his life to end. He's marinating in self-pity. And sure enough, this time there was a woman to blame. Because after that triumph on Mount Carmel, King Ahab had squealed on Elijah to evil Queen Jezebel all that Elijah had done in trying to turn people back to the worship of the true God. And contrary to common sense, contrary to all evidence, nothing had really changed. Ahab and Jezebel's hearts had been hard as nails, just like Pharaoh's had hardened his heart in Moses' day. The people went back to worshiping Baal and all of the other pagan deities just as before. They didn't return in their hearts to the Lord. The revival was only very temporary and on the surface. All that effort, all that risk, all that courage that Elijah had expended, it all seemed to come to nothing. And Jezebel had issued a death warrant for Elijah and sealed it with her own oath, saying, "May the gods do whatever they want to with me if by time tomorrow, this time, I haven't made your life like one of those prophets of Baal and Asherah have been executed." And just like that, Elijah was a wanted man, wanted, dead or alive. And he was terrified. He packed up his bags, he headed to the outback, and there he lay under a broom tree, totally depressed. He was a wanted man. Jezebel wanted him, and she wanted him dead. But Elijah no longer wanted himself. He wanted to die, but he didn't want to be murdered. And Elijah exhibited all the classic signs of depression: slow movement, wallowing in self-pity, feeling sadness, tears welling up in the eyes, despairing of life, feeling isolated, totally alone. He didn't even want his assistant to be with him. He asked him, "You stay here, I'll go even further out." He believed his life was totally a failure. He felt useless and worthless. He lost his appetite, and he desired to do nothing but just sleep. We all have moments of depression, burnout, times of low energy. And a church can work so hard and do so many good things, and then things don't seem to change around it. Listen to what Elijah had to say in his lament. "It's more than enough, Lord. Take my life, because I'm no better than my ancestors." He lay down and he slept under a solitary broom bush. Elijah was a wanted man. Jezebel wanted him, and she wanted him dead. He wanted himself dead for that matter, but God also wanted him, and God wanted him alive. And notice how God in this story came on the scene. He sent a messenger, an angel. That's all the word in the Hebrew malachi means, is a messenger. An angel came, and God provided a life-sustaining meal. "Get up. Eat something." And Elijah opened his eyes and saw flatbread baked on a glowing coals and a jar of water right under his head, by his head, and he ate and drank. And what did he do? Go back to sleep. Like a Jewish mother, God said, "Get up and eat something." That's just the way God is. Fed him real food and real drink. I just want to say, I'm glad that this is Soup Sunday. I called Pastor Tierra a couple of weeks ago. I said, I learned that Soup Sunday is February, February 5th. You know, could I come up and participate? She said, "Yeah, why don't you preach while you're here?" So, appreciate that. But one of the most spiritual things you can do is to feed somebody. Did you know Jesus ate his way through the Gospels? Think of how many stories throughout the four Gospels that had to do with something about food. Even what we're going to participate in is the climax of this service. Everything's building up to the fact that we eat and drink and take in Christ. He said, I've desired to have this meal. Come and eat. Not as bare permission, but as a positive command. Come and eat. Get out. Eat. Sustain yourself with something. You don't ever get close to anyone if you don't eat with them. Jesus ate his way through the Gospels. Feeding others, accepting invitations, calling a man down out of a sycamore tree, Zacchaeus, come home, I'm going to go eat with you today. He ate with Matthew, he ate with the tax collectors. He was criticized for who he would eat with because he didn't draw any boundaries. He just ate with people. This church will never really bond together unless you eat together. You need to have more times of eating together, I believe. And you have to take the initiative, invite someone to eat with you. And I mean real food. I'm not talking some kind of spiritual stuff here. I'm talking about ask them over for a meal. Tell them that you'll take them out. Go out with them. Eat with them. Give them your attention and share food together. That's what Jesus did. But God knew that this defeated, depressed prophet, he knew exactly what he needed. And he let him rest. And the Lord's messenger came to him a second time. Tactic. The messenger said, eat something because you have a difficult road ahead of you. God had something in mind for Elijah. He wasn't finished with him. God wanted him to flourish again. And Elijah was wallowing in self-pity, but God let him speak, let him pour out his complaint to experience a healthy catharsis. I was very depressed when I was 17. I've told this story before. Somebody said, don't tell that story again. I'm going to tell it again. People keep going back to, you know, to hear Jimmy Buffett play the same song again. And some of you have laughed politely at some of my Harry Nedda jokes, even though you already knew that the punchline. But when I was 17, I was very depressed. You know, I was going to high school. I had no real goals in life. I didn't know what I was going to do when I graduated. I didn't really think about it. I had no idea God might use me in ministry. That wasn't even on my horizon at the time. I wasn't resistant. I just didn't have even thought about it. But I was so depressed, and I was very confused. My church was having some problems that I had been brought up in. And that affects kids, let me tell you. It affects young people. But I had met some kids that were in the Jesus movement, ex-hippies, long-haired kids, blue jeans, and all that. And I had met them on the street, and I found out they were having a meeting one night, so after I finished work at Sears and Roebuck on Ponce de Leon Avenue, I got in my car and I went down to Piedmont Avenue, and I decided to go to this house ministry. There was 60 or 70 kids that were there, young people, mostly teenagers, early 20s, long-haired kids, and they were all sitting around in kind of a Bible study, and I went to the house. I didn't know a single person there. I went into the door. I sat in the doorway, and it was hot inside, cold outside, hot inside. And it was I was getting kind of sleepy. And the preacher was around the corner sitting down teaching. Kids were going up the balcony. They were on the staircase. They were sitting on all the furniture and on the floor. It was a full house. I wasn't listening. Too much was being said. But after it was over, everybody jumped up. They were so joyful. I was not. And as the kids began to hug each other and talk and converse and go over to the snack table and get something to eat, one guy came out of it. And came and he saw me, and he came over and said, my name is David. What's yours? And it was very odd because David had a speech impediment. He talked rather funny, but he didn't let that be a barrier to make eye contact and talk with a stranger. I said, I'm Kim. He said, well, Kim, do you know the Lord? I said, well, yeah, you know, but I'm very confused. He could have thought, well, this is a difficult case. You know, why don't we go get something to eat? But he said, would you like to talk about it? I said, yeah, I would. He said, let's go find a quiet place. So we went over in the corner somewhere, and he sat down and engaged me in deep conversation. He said, what seems to be going on in your life? And I was just telling him a lot of my teenage angst. It was really silly when I look back on it. But at the time, he took moments to learn my name, look at me in the eye, and ask me a question, get me started to have a little catharsis. And he never answered my question. It wasn't that I was looking for an answer. He just said, sometimes I feel the same way, you know. And then we had some prayers together, and I started going. That was a turning point in my life because he took just a few minutes. And then we went over and got some food together. That made a difference in me. You never know what stone you're throwing into a pond, and when it hits, bloop, and the ripples go all the way out to the edge. You never know how much influence little acts of kindness may do. Well, Elijah had gotten up and went down further south. He got up and went to Horeb. Isn't that an interesting thing? In this, by the time that this was written, Horeb was the same mountain as Mount Sinai. Now, what happened on Mount Sinai? Sinai was the Mount of God where God had met Moses some centuries before, given the Ten Commandments, with lightning and earthquake and storms and darkness and everything was happening. The burning bush, all of that was down at Horeb. Elijah went back to that mountain of God, now called Horeb instead of Sinai, and Elijah found himself in a cave that was a tomb-like place, which soon became a womb-like place where new life was to be born, where he was about to have a fresh encounter with God. God invited Elijah to vent. What are you doing here, Elijah? Not just here geographically, but this state of mind that you're in. What are you doing here? God is such a good counselor. In fact, the Bible speaks of him as being the wonderful counselor. And he invites us to tell exactly how we feel and what has brought us to this place of despair. Do you know the psalms or prayers that were put to music, sung in the temple by choirs and by individuals? And one-third of the psalms, 150 psalms, one-third of them are laments, which are complaints. Did you know that some of the complaints was complain about God? How long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? When are you going to get on the throne and do what you said you're going to do? Some of the and God can take it. The entire book of the Bible is named Lamentations, that was complaining. Now, I'm not talking about complaining in the parking lot. I'm talking about complaining to God. I'm not talking about complaining about your preacher either. I'm talking about complaining to God. God is a good counselor, and he invites us to talk. And this is what Elijah said. I don't know if he thought God didn't know this, but he's telling God some stuff here. I've been very passionate for the Lord God of heavenly forces because the Israelites have abandoned your covenant. Did you know that? They have torn down your altars. They have murdered your prophets with the sword. I'm the only one left. And they want to take my life too now. If God invited you to say, you know, spend a few minutes with me and just tell me what's on your mind, what's bothering you, what would you say? What complaint would you have? Would you complain that the job didn't work out and you got passed over for another promotion the third year in a row, or that the marriage was falling apart after 25 years, or you had 38 years of service and you got laid off, clean out your desk, good luck, and you leave with a small severance pay, or have all your ducks in a row, all your bills are paid, the college loans are almost solvent, you're diagnosed with pancreatic cancer, or your boyfriend or girlfriend jumped up ship. I don't know what the complaint is, but we have problems. We all have problems. We're human beings. That's why we need each other. That's why we come to church and eat together and worship together and pray together, because we need each other. And we all have our problems. God wanted Elijah. And God listened, and God heard Elijah's complaint. And God answered, but in a different, new way. Elijah had journeyed all the way back to Horeb, the mountain of God, that other name for Mount Sinai, where Moses had met God, received the Ten Commandments back at the beginning. Perhaps God would just come on the scene again, and it'd be like back in the old days. I remember that song that I grew up in the Pentecostal church, give me that old time. Give me that old time religion. It's good enough for me. And people have that. I cop to the past. I wish things were back the way it used to be. Remember when Broad Street, Burlington used to have a full balcony and a youth group of 60 strong and had plays and all that? Oh, if we could just get back and it'd be like that again. Couldn't be. I just wish, you know, life is so different now. Not, it wasn't the way I grew up. This isn't the America I know. I know all the complaints. But listen what God did. A very strong wind said, the Lord passed by. And a very strong wind tore through the mountains. It broke apart the stones before the Lord. But then what happened? Read it with me. The Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, there was an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. After the earthquake, there was a fire. But
the Lord was not in the fire.
And after the fire, after these extraordinary things that had happened at Horeb back when, it says that it was a thin, quiet. There was a sound, thin and quiet. Did you hear that refrain? God was not in the wind, not in the earthquake, not in the fire, not in the old time religion tried to bring it back to life and do it again. Afterwards, there was that moment of stillness fraught with significance. I love the way the King James put it. It was a still, small voice. But it's better to understand it as a very pregnant silence. So thick you could cut it with a knife. And what did God do? God let it be known that he was not finished with Elijah. God was not finished with him. God fed him food twice. God listened to him, asked him, why are you here? Why are you complaining? Two times in the text. And then God lays on Elijah another divine mission. The Lord said to him, go back through the desert to Damascus and anoint Hazael, king of Aram. That's Syria today. Also anoint Jehu, Nimshi's son, as king of Israel. And anoint Elijah from Abel-Meholath, Shaphat's son, to succeed you as a prophet. God wasn't finished with Elijah. God was about to signal a regime change both in Syria and in Israel. God would judge the wicked kings and replace them with new kings. And God wanted to enlist Elijah to be a teacher in a training program in which he will serve as a mentor to his successor, Elisha. God had more for Elijah to do. His ministry wasn't over. In my ministry, I spent about 10 of the happiest years of my life right here. The last year and a half has been even happier since I retired. I don't ever have to communicate to the bishop at all. No reports filed. No SBRC meetings, no council meetings or anything. I've enjoyed it. I really have. But I've faced times of despondency and depression, low energy and feeling hopeless at times, many times. Just because I'm a pastor doesn't mean I'm not human and I don't have the same thing. Elijah was a pretty great man of God, right? But he had these low points and wanted to die. God never said, you're through. It's all over. You know, when we lived in Taiwan, you know, the Chinese fortune cookies, they're always positive. You never open one up. It says, you know, quit while you're ahead, you're a jerk. And I've never opened, anything that God has said to me. Is, you're over, it's done, you've blown it. God nurtured me gently and tenderly and ministered to me like a loving mother, like a Jewish mother. Sometimes I felt like I was holed up in a cave, but my cave, that tomb-like place, became a womb-like place where I experienced new life, rebirth, renewed energy, and fresh vision, and reasons to live, and a new assignment in life. We've left places. Sometimes it was very depressing to say goodbye to ministry that we had put in and the people that we'd met and invested our lives in, and all of a sudden we say goodbye. That can be depression. But when I got out of my head and reached out to someone else, I found that I had become a channel of grace to someone else. And then my own despair lifted like a curtain, and my spirit was rejuvenated, and renewed strength pulsed through my body. And clouds of despondency cleared away like the morning mists under the burning sun. Perhaps you're in a state of funk right now. It's possible for a whole congregation to experience a collective state of uncertainty. What's the future hold? But God knows, and God will continue to feed and give rest and will still meet you in that still small voice, whisper words of comfort, and offer a challenge of a renewed mission. And what I like about this is at the very end of that text about Elijah, there's a divine PS, a divine postscript. Elijah, by the way, you're not the only one. Elijah mistakenly thought that he was the only one left. I'm the only one left. They've killed your prophets. They've desecrated your altars. I'm the only one left. The only sole faithful disciple of the Lord. No one has been more faithful than me. Well, he was wrong. God reminded him, you know, P.S., I have preserved those who remain in Israel, totally 7,000, all whose knees haven't bowed down to Baal and whose mouths hasn't kissed him. Just know you're not alone. There's many Christians around here, not only this church, but the Baptist Church and City of Refuge and the Way Community Church and the Episcopal Church and the Catholic Church. There are people that are children of God all over this place doing little acts of kindness, living for Jesus. You're not alone. God is here. God is present. Many other people are going through the same things you are. You're not useless. But to God, you're special. To God, your life is precious even when you don't see it yourself. And God has a mission for your life. God has something for you to do. Someone God wants to use you to reach out and touch. Can you say amen?
Amen.
All right. We are ready to take communion, I believe. But I think we're going to have a song first, right?
We're going to have a song first.
All right.
Blessed be your name.
Christ our Lord invites to his table all who truly and earnestly repent of their sin and desire to live in peace with God and with each other. So let us therefore confess our sins before God and in one another's presence. Let us pray.
Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors. We have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Forgive us for joyful obedience. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Take a moment and confess our personal sins to God. Here is some good news. Christ died for us when we were still sinners. That proves God's love for us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen.
Amen. Turn to page 15, Service of Word and Table 2. We prepare the elements and bless them and remember that Christ fed his disciples and desired to eat with us. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and good always and everywhere to give thanks to you, O Lord, because you are the one who takes us out of the pit, cleans us up, and puts us on a solid rock and establish our going. You have helped us when we were down. You have brought this congregation through many dangers, toils, and snares, and yet you have a mission for us to continue on. We thank you, O God, for that. And so with your people on earth and all of the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn saying,
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, who on the night he gave himself up for us, Jesus took the bread, blessed it, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples and said, take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And after the bread, Jesus took the cup. And when he had given thanks and blessed it, he gave it to his disciples. And he said, take and drink from this, all of you. This is the cup of the new covenant and my blood poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me. And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and a living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of our faith. That Christ has died,
Christ is risen, and Christ will come again.
We give you thanks, O Lord, and pray for you to bless us gathered here out of love for you and one another, and put your blessing on this bread and this cup, that they may become for us the effective signs of Christ's body and blood, that we might become the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood, broken and put out into the world, to give life and sustenance to the world. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. The table has been set. All things are ready. Let's prepare to take the communion. Jesus said, this is my body broken for you. Let us take the bread together as the people of God and remember Jesus. Jesus said, this cup is a new covenant in my blood poured out for you and many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me. Let us take it and be grateful. Lord, we thank you for feeding us with this holy sacrament, uniting us with Christ once again, forgiving us of our sins, uniting us with one another. Make us one in ministry to all the world until you come again in final victory, and we'll feast with you forever. We also pray, O Lord, that you'll bless the soup Sunday, the food that's there waiting for us, all the hands that prepared it. Let us have a good time of fellowship as we eat together in the joy of the Lord. In his name we pray, and all God's children said,
Amen.
Please rise for the
Lord's
blessing. Today is all we have. We will rejoice, we will be renewed, and we will learn from the past. Cherish today and welcome the future, because you have given us a powerful and sacred history.
We will teach and learn, speak and listen, and grow strong every day of every month. Amen.
Service is now over. Go and be blessed. Live fire, so please don't use the house.